American girls and American guys, we'll always stand up and salute. We'll always recognize when we see old glory flying. There's a lot of men dead, so we can sleep in peace at night when we lay down our heads. My daddy served in the army. We lost his right eye, but he flew a flag out in our yard till the day that he died. He wanted my mother, my brother, my sister and me to grow up and live happy in the land of the free. Now this nation that I love is falling under attack. A mighty sucker punch came flying in from somewhere in the back. Soon as we could see clearly through our big black eye, man, we lit up your world like the 4th of July. Hey, Uncle Sam, put your name at the top of his list. And the Statue of Liberty started shaking her fist. And the eagle will fly, and it's gonna be here when you hear Mother Freedom start ringing her bell. And it'll feel like the whole wide world is raining down on you. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue. This big dog will fight when you rattle his cage. And you'll be sorry that you mess with the U.S. of A. 'Cause we'll put a boot in your ass, it's the American way. Hey, Uncle Sam, put your name at the top of his list. And the Statue of Liberty started shaking her fist. And the eagle will fly, and it's gonna be hell when you hear Mother Freedom start ringing her bell. And it'll feel like the whole wide world is raining down on you. Courtesy of the red, white, and blue.
Good morning, WBAM. This is me, Bonley Johnson, and my beautiful co-host, Jen X. Say hi, Jen.
Hi, Jen.
Hi, Jen. Started off a little Toby Keith this morning. Probably a mistake. Yeah, I got a little emotional. Yeah. All right,
damn you.
That's all right. What a great song. Great guy.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. The song gets me emotional anyway. And then with the loss of Toby this week, it was
a bit
ultra emotional.
It was a bit much. It was probably a mistake. That's all right. Let's have to talk about something
It's a great song.
It's a great song.
It should be heard over and over and over.
Probably should. Makes me a little sad.
Yeah. It'll get better.
What did you do yesterday?
What did I do yesterday? I don't think I did a whole lot of anything yesterday. Peyton, my granddaughter, was over, and she's not feeling very well. She was kind of puny, and it was all, Mimi this, and Mimi this, and Mimi, will you get this, and Mimi, can I have this, and Mimi, I just want to sit with you, and, you know, but...
You're a little needy sometimes.
Other than, okay, hey, though. It was a good day. It was a good day. I love spending time with her.
Listen, we love being needed when it's by somebody like that.
Well, she's kind of cute.
When somebody who is needy and they're little and tiny and cute, it's okay.
What did you do?
When they're grown-ass adults and they're needy, it's sometimes a little annoying. But that's a different story. What did I do? I spent the day I started out, wanted to work on my Vanster, the little golf cart van.
Geronimo!
Geronimo, yes. I was going to work on Geronimo. And so Geronimo has spit a spark plug out of the jug. The jug is the cylinder head kind of thingy. There's no heads on those if anybody out there is mechanical. It's the jug is it's all one piece. Slides over the piston. Piston slides up and down the side. But anyhow, spark plug goes into that. So I went and bought a borescope. It's a little camera thingy. It's got a long flexible tube on it, and you can stick it down into holes. Look, and it has a little monitor screen. You watch it. And...
So are you telling me I could save some money on my colonoscopy?
Yes. Come on.
Are you willing? Are you willing to perform the procedure, Dr. Bonley?
Of course.
All right, go ahead.
I can't guarantee your well-being, and you're going to be awake when we do it. They'll put you out
there. Oh, shit. No.
And when they do the endoscopy, they use a different camera. I will not.
As long as you go down before you go up, we're all right.
Order matters. Because
give me a couple of those muscle relaxers and let's go.
Oh, man. I fucking feel hungover. Those things beat the shit out of me. I'd be a terrible drug addict. I really would. I don't think I'd last a month.
Or a really good one.
Yeah, cheap. I'd be a cheap date, that's for sure. just blow some crack smoke in my face. That'd be plenty. Thank you. I'll be high for a week. But, yeah. So I bought the borescope, and I stuck it down in the piston, and there was a giant hole in the side of the threads that blew completely out. The whole thing was completely gone. So I spent about an hour being pissed about it and depressed about it. I'm like, then I thought, well, you know, I bought this fucking expensive spark plug repair kit because I thought, well, you know, this is the best one. I'll buy it. It should work. Well, of course, after I saw that, I was like, well, I could see that there was potential that if I ran that thing down in there, it was just going to crumble. But then I thought to myself, what's it going to hurt? It's already junk. There's no fixing that short of if this thing works and they come with little inserts that go down in the hole after you clean it up with the threads. The thread expands it to a bigger hole or the tap expands it to a bigger hole. Then you put these inserts in and then your spark plug fits right in there. Excuse me. So I thought, what's it going to hurt, right? What's it going to hurt?
Right.
But it did. It crumbled. It came out in pieces. It's junk. It's toast. So then my search for a replacement engine. Well, of course, being from 1989. And as it turns out, it was like one of the last years they put that motor in. So it was already an old, outdated motor when it got into my poor little Vanster. So that started me down a path. I started down this path. I'm like, what can I do? What can I do? My pea brain was like, hey, just buy some golf cart axles and put under and make a golf cart out of it, you know, which is possible because, you know, rear springs, they just kind of mount with U-bolts onto the frame. You can put them pretty much however you want. The stance might be a little different, but that turned out to be kind of expensive. And then I found this company, Power something like that, but they make a kit just for that Cushman. So I spent some money and bought a...
Must be a common problem?
Well, let's say the people that own these stupid things, they're pretty rare, the survivors. Mm-hmm. But the people that own them are fairly passionate about them, apparently. So they spend money. So anytime there's money involved, there's money to be made, somebody's going to make you whatever you want. And that's what this company is... They do it for all the golf carts, so you can upgrade the motors, take those crappy old little air-cooled motors out of them, put nice air-cooled motors in them. So that's what I did. I bought a fuel-injected motor, so I don't have to mess with the carburetor, and a kit that mounts right in there. So hopefully, this whole thing, I'm only doing it at this because I have other projects right now that are ahead of it, but they're getting bumped because I want this to be done by the time you guys get here.
You know, we don't give a crap about that engine and all that motor stuff.
No,
we don't care.
You just want it to run.
We just Right. We want it to run and we want that body.
Right. That's all we
like that. Or I like that body.
Yeah, it's all people care about. They just want to get a little ride in it. And I'm down with that because I want to too. I got 15 minutes out of poor Geronimo and down the toilet we had to flush him. Poor little feller. He didn't need to have no life, poor little feller. But so it'll be done. They promised me 24/7, 365, whatever, tech support. We'll see. They're from Eugene, Oregon.
Tisha says she's bringing a crash test helmet.
Well, you know, I discovered so much about this fucking stupid little golf cart thing. Because I knew nothing when I bought it. Obviously, you knew that.
Right.
Now I know, like, all the specs, all this crap, because I was trying to find out what the motor was. And I never did find out officially what the motor was, because even Cushman was like, we don't know. That's too old.
Yeah, you were talking to somebody who wasn't born yet.
Right.
When the
But they're the ones that made the damn thing. And they're like, well, this is what they told me, like, all the specs, it's the year and blah, 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 which I knew the year. It says it right on the side of it. So, I mean, that was not a mystery. But I found out the horsepower rating and how much weight you can. This thing is a half ton. It has the same capacity as a full-size pickup. This thing was made to pull shit and carry shit. I mean, it was legit. It was a legit little factory cart back in the day. They must have really... I mean, it's heavy duty for as little as it is. It's ridiculous. So I'm going to weld a hitch on that bad boy. That's what I'm going to do. She getting a hitch. Old Geronimo.
Now you can pull all the rest of your junk golf.
Yes. See how genius it is? Sometimes these stories just write themselves.
Are you going to tag it as a farm vehicle?
I don't think I'm going to tag it. I'm just going to be a rebel. No, I'm going to get tags for it. I have a clear title on it, and it's been tagged before as a street legal vehicle. So I just can't take it on the interstate. That's it.
Why you can't take it on the interstate?
It won't go fast enough. Interstate travel requires you to do at least 55. Oh. The vehicle has to be able to do at least 55 miles an hour in Ohio to get on the interstate.
Gotcha. The minimum.
Minimum. Yeah. I think minimum is 45 speed wise.
So can you get here without taking an interstate? Yes.
Yeah. Technically, I could drive that thing all the way to your house. I cannot imagine.
It'd take you 4 days to get here.
But this new motor, I'm excited because it's got 5 more horsepower than the old one. And B, it's fuel injected. I don't have to mess with the carburetor. I don't have to mess with it.
Is that going to increase your speed?
A little bit, yeah. Plus I put slightly bigger tires on it. No, I'm thinking I might be able to push 40 out of it right now when I get that all done. That's my guess. Damn it. But I get more RPMs and more torque out of this one, too. So I don't know. I don't know. It'll never get 55. 55 would be dangerous in that thing. It would be extremely dangerous.
You know what's next? We're going to have to buy a radar detector so we can clock it.
Chronograph. We'll get a chronograph. Well, same thing.
Well, y'all fancy. Mm-hmm. I haven't had a speeding ticket since I used radar.
Well, I mean, they call them radar detectors, but they're chronographs.
Oh, okay. Well, you mean like
the real name
I said radar detector. Radar detector as in like right. What the consumer would use.
Right.
And that was wrong.
They call them radar guns. The cops do. They call them radar guns.
Yes.
But they're chronographs. That's what like a tachometer in your car. I was like, well, that's my RPM gauge. Well, the real term is tachometer. An ammeter, an odometer. Where's my miles? I'm just saying. Technically, it's a chronograph. It measures distance and how fast you cover that distance.
Gotcha.
How long it takes
I wrote that down, so I won't make that mistake.
Not a mistake. I'm just educating the public. It's my job. It's what I do. We have discussions and people leave. People leave Morning Bull smarter than they came in.
Do they really?
Yes. It's my job. This is my story.
I don't know. For every tidbit of information you give, our stupidity takes some away.
Listen, we talked about this show since the inception of WBAM. We just called it Q&A before. Short of Saltem and Heather being in the room at the same time, this is basically the same show. So if you guys in chat have any questions that you want the wrong answers to, feel free. Send us your questions. We don't care. I mean, if you want to know how to build a nuclear submarine, we will tell you how to do it. Just don't try it at home. Because
it might work.
It might. Then you'll never have to fuel your sub again. It'll just float around and around and around. Now, speaking of the gas crunch, did you know that the...
Probably not.
U.S. Navy has ships that run off of hydrogen power?
Off of what?
Hydrogen power.
I was not aware, but I'm not surprised. Did you know that Schwann's run their trucks from propane?
Yes, I did know that.
And it's smart. You just like maybe not know something?
Well, then talk about something that doesn't have wheels or tits on it, and I won't know nothing. But these boats literally suck in seawater, right? And use it as fuel. It converts it to hydrogen. Or something along those lines. So they literally never have to come home for fuel. And I think they make clean water. I think that's what comes out the exhaust. Crazy, right?
Yeah. They make clean water.
Mm-hmm.
Like they filter it for all the fishies.
Well, the fishies like the salty water. So it's probably not that good for
the fishies. Actually not doing a good service.
Well, according to the, we'll just let that go. We'll let that go. Because, you know, plants breathe carbon dioxide, right? So when I'm running when I'm running my little golf cart, I'm making plant air.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm doing the environment a favor. I'm a hero. Yeah. I'm literally a hero.
Well, I mean, I always kind of thought that too. I didn't understand what the big deal was, but
we won't get into that discussion. Let me tell you this now: you're not wrong. You're not wrong.
But my mind is very simplified. You know, I mean, I'm sure there's so much more to it.
Nope, you're not wrong.
Photosynthesis.
Yep, you're not wrong. That's all I got to say about that. Of course. So anyhow, you take a giant empty submarine, all right?
Can it be yellow?
Yes, of course. Okay. That's one of the learning songs in guitar, at guitar lessons. We call it P&G, picking and grinning.
Yeah.
And it's one of the ones that Sally Mancini hates, fucking hates playing...
I'm not a fan either, but I just feel like everything needs to be song related.
Over and over. Dun 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 dun. Over and over. Like when I was
go back to your yellow submarine. No, tell me about your yellow submarine.
I was gonna say you take a giant empty submarine, paint it yellow, keep it in your backyard in the pool, and
I'm gonna need a pool.
You go to Amazon, you buy a nuclear fusion engine, and you put it in the back and attach a little propane or a propeller to it. Viola, you have a nuclear submarine in your backyard.
I'm gonna need a pool.
Well, I mean, everybody has a pool, don't they?
I do not. Do you have a pool?
No, not really.
All right, then.
I got a creek out back.
Okay. A creek? I used to have a creek.
Yeah, I got a little creek running around.
They moved They moved the crick. Now the crick is in front of the house.
They dug this one out, so it doesn't stay full year round now. I think it's under the ground when it's dry. As soon as it rains, she's back to life. But you know, it's flooded. It's flooded since I've been here, so I know the farmers. The crick divides my farm and the next farm.
Did you just say floated?
Probably.
It's floated. It's floated since I've been here.
Flooded.
Flooded. Flooded.
Yeah. It's flooded my field since we've lived here. And I've only been here a little over a year. We've had it for a few years, but we've been building. We've only been living here about a year.
It takes time.
Oh, yeah. There's no doubt. I'm not worried about it. I mean, the house is livable. I just got pieces, parts.
Just don't become complacent with your
too late
with your unfinished home, because it's very hard to finish it once you become complacent.
Mm-hmm.
But you just never do. You never do. It just never happens.
Well, I don't think I don't think this house will ever be done.
You stop noticing things that aren't finished. When we first bought this house, and mm-hmm. I mean, and it's an old house. It was built in the 1940s, but my stairs were carpeted with this mm-hmm. god awful mauve carpet. You mm-hmm. remember it from the 80s?
Oh,
like
yeah.
Everybody had the mauve carpet with that little design through it. And it was dirty and it was hideous. So one of the first things I did was yank that carpet off the stairs.
Rose colored carpet.
Yeah, yeah. So I pulled the carpet off the stairs, and the stairs were not in the greatest shape, but they were, you know, they were wood. They were okay. But mm-hmm. I thought, okay, I'm going to redo those stairs.
What do you mean redo? So pull the wood out? Or are you just talking about sanding them?
I was sanding. I wanted to sand and refinish.
Okay.
So I sanded them off, and then like a shitstorm happened, you know, life. And I never finished it.
Mm-hmm.
And before my mom passed, she told me, she said, "Sis, are you ever going to finish those stairs?" I mean, we'd been here for like 5 years. I'm like, you know, I really don't even notice it anymore. I had taken the railing down and everything. It was an eyesore. It was an eyesore. But I didn't even notice it anymore because I saw it every day. It was just my normal. And I promised her that. I said, "Okay, Mom." I said, I promise before Christmas, I will have these stairs done.
Right.
Well, my mom passed away that October. And then, so after she passed away, I knew I had made her a promise. So I knew that I had to finish those stairs. And I had a short period of time to do it between the time that she passed away and Christmas. But anyway, I did finally get the stairs finished. But it was, I don't think I've done anything since.
Well, because you didn't
promise. And there's lots
to
be done. To
somebody who passed away. That's kind of, that's a lot of fucking pressure, man.
Well, motivation.
What it takes. Not that. I'm not saying you have to wait till people pass away. That's awful. But,
I'm thinking, who's about to die?
Motivation is what it takes. Like, my garage is so full of shit right now. We just moved all of our stuff into our garage because the garage is heated. So it didn't matter. It wasn't going to freeze. And that's part of the issue. It made us lazy because we didn't have to get in a hurry and put everything in the house. We're still bringing shit. A year later, we're still bringing shit in from the garage. Hey, where's blah, blah, blah? We're like, I bet that fucking thing's out in the garage. I bet it is.
Yep. I feel you. I'm telling you, I do.
Yeah.
We've got stuff. We have the garage and we have our pole barn building. Mm-hmm. Both of them are just jam-packed full of shit.
It's a miracle. It is a literal miracle how much crap you can accumulate. Bailey and I lived in, Barclay and I lived in that house for 8 years. That's it, 8 years. It sounds like a long time, but it's not. And it was a tiny house. It was built in the 1800s, the late 1800s, like 1890s. But it was a brick house. It was a nice house. It was a cute little thing. But we had to, and we thought we had plenty of room to live. And we're like, oh, we can't wait till we build the big house. And then we'll, you know, we'll have so much, and nope. Nope, there's shit everywhere still.
Well, the more
I don't
space
care how much
have,
space
more,
you have. Yeah, It doesn't matter.
The more space you have, the more shit you have. It's kind of like, you know, with money, the more money that you make, the more money you spend.
Oh, of course. Yeah. Freedom is a drug, man. It is.
Yep.
Remodeling is a bitch.
I need more space and more money.
Remodeling's a bitch. It's a lover. It's a I tried. What are you remodeling? Tisha is remodeling her studio. That's what she's doing.
She is, but mm-hmm. she's also remodeling her home.
Yeah. A little bit at a time. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A little at a time.
If only she were married to a person who like worked in construction and built things for a living.
Wouldn't that be the dream?
It would. Could you imagine?
Yeah. Seems like maybe she could get that house remodeled a little bit faster.
She would have everything she ever wanted. Her daughter's room would be done. The basement would be done. The studio would be.
If only.
Tisha, that's what you need. You need to leave Pat and go marry a construction worker. That's what you need to do.
I see Peg and Nady dropped in chat this morning. Good morning, Susan.
Good morning. I saw Boca was out there, Ben's out there. This is like romper, bumper, stomper, boo. If you're in chat.
Romper, bumper, stomper, boo. I don't think that, is that how that went?
Yeah, but I don't remember the rest of it. Yeah, but I don't remember the rest of it.
I don't remember any of it.
What was her name? Miss Anne?
I don't know that either.
Something like that.
I just remember like that magic mirror thing.
Yeah. But I don't remember her name was, like Miss Anne or Miss Megan or Miss something like that. Yeah, it was
I don't remember.
They ran that show like a classroom. Like it reminded me when I went to kindergarten reminded me of Romper Room.
You know, I think I was just kind of like in my own little world until I was 12.
Yeah.
For real. Like I just.
What world was that?
Just mine. Just how mine. Like there was nobody else there. When I was in first grade, my parents would get called to the school because they would be like, Jennifer is just, well, she's slow. And mom's like, what do you mean she's slow? She's very smart. I'm like, no. What do you mean she's physically slow? Like everybody would eat their lunch and go out to recess and do all of their things. And they'd be coming back to class. And I was just finishing lunch and putting my coat on to go outside. I never got recess. I was just always just in my own little world.
I don't see an issue with that.
Well, I didn't say there was an issue with it. I mean, I think people would find issues with it.
Especially school, because everything's so... I can't speak for now, but back then everything was structured. Yes, very regimented. That's the word. That's a better word than routine. Very regimented. Everything was on tut, 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 tut. And if you didn't get along with the tut, 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 they thought something was wrong with you.
I was slow.
I mean, we know that, but no, you're not. You get things done. But there's nothing wrong with taking your time and doing it your way. I don't think anyway.
Well,
I'm impatient.
I do it when I fucking feel like it.
Right. I'm always too anxious about what, you know, whoever is in my life at whatever capacity we're talking about, work, home or whatever. I'm always worried about what the other person expects of me. So I get anxious and I do things sometimes too hurriedly.
I think that you probably have a habit of choosing people to be in your life who have expectations.
Probably. Like work, I don't have any control over who's in my work life. I kind of do,
no.
but I don't.
No, I mean, who works there. You get what you get.
But again, just like you or your demeanor and my demeanor, I don't think there's anything wrong with, you know, trying to meet people's expectations. That's what makes me feel good.
I mean, accomplishing it's all things. You. If that's what makes you.
It does. That's part of what makes me. That's part of what drives me. I'm hard on myself. I'm very self-critical.
No.
And it makes me better at things. Didn't say it made me good, but it does make me better than I was.
Think how bad it could be.
Exactly. If I was all nonchalant. I think WBAM radio is a nice little thing we did. For as short a period of time as we've had it.
I do too. I enjoy it.
I've had WBAM longer than I've had my house. Longer than I've lived in it anyway. But only like by a week or two.
That's not true.
Oh, you're right, because I moved in before Christmas. And we didn't start till after January. Okay. Yep. I stand corrected.
Wrong again.
He's so hard on me. Yeah, you're right. I'm wrong. I got that backwards. But it's pretty close. They started about the same time.
They did. Lots of things kind of happened all at once for us about a year ago.
Yeah, I literally, right about now is when I was planning on launching the station.
Lots of things happened. Good things. Lots of good things.
It's just everything like just hit the ground running and took off. Yeah. Like you got all that shit done on the website and on Zeno and all that. And then it was just like, all right, fuck it.
You know why?
Let's go.
You know why?
Why?
Because I fucking felt like it.
Because you fucking felt like it. Listen, I think the negative experiences that we had in the radio world from the other quote unquote stations, because let's be honest, this is just internet fun that we're doing. It's not really a radio station. We don't broadcast anywhere other than over the internet.
You're right.
So I like calling it radio because I'm a fan of radio.
It's basically fun with friends.
It is. But I think the negative experiences that we had and the way our brains are wired, we knew there could be more. We knew that that experience could have been way more enriching and fulfilling. That's why we moved on and did our own thing. And it's only fate that we found ourselves together. Because you and I, although we talked here and there, do you remember your first nickname?
My what?
The first nickname I gave you. Because I always nickname people.
Buckeye Badass.
That's right. She's the Buckeye Badass. Yep.
Yeah. I do remember that.
Mm-hmm. But we didn't talk. We never really had a personal conversation other than right out in public and chat. Not that I remember. And then how the hell did it come to be that we were talking about this? And then you said you wanted to start your own radio station.
I'm not sure why I came to you with that. I'm not sure, but I had already kind of set the groundwork for something different.
Mm-hmm.
And
Saltam and I were in on it too. We had already started what we were planning on doing.
You all had started your discussions and I was flying solo. And I don't know, maybe I was kind of looking for a partner or subconsciously, you know, but I don't really know why I decided to open up and tell you that I was working on that, because I had already set the groundwork for something different, an all country station. And anyway, and you're like, well,
I remember telling you, hold on a minute.
Yes.
And then I remember going back to Salt and I was like, hey, what if, and hear me out, what if there's somebody else who feels the same way we do about KFAG and the other one, KBKG, and they want to do their own? She's like, well, who is it? I'm like, I can't tell you because they don't want anyone to know either, just like we don't want anybody to know we're doing it. And she was like, do you trust them? I said, yeah, I trust them. She said, then you can tell them. And then that's how that all started.
Yeah, and then you put us in the same room, and I was like, mm-hmm. what the? I had no idea. And it was just all meant to be.
Yep.
Meant to happen the way that it did. It was just...
She had people from that other station just like pressuring her to do this show.
Huh?
There was the pile of cow shit had a acoustic show on that other station.
Yeah, right.
And didn't like doing it. And she thought in her brain that her friend Salton would be perfect for that show. So she went to the station, was like, listen, I want to steal Salton from this station and put her on here on this show. I don't want to do my show anymore. My second show. Right. It was her second show.
Right.
But she never really asked Salton. She was just assumed that, you know, she would follow her and do exactly what she wanted to do. And I think that hurt her feelings a little bit. Salton's feelings. Like, she didn't even ask her. She just was expecting.
Well, Salton kind of got this. She kind of got the same treatment in the other station that she and I were in together. She was just kind of told, okay, we're going to change your show. You're going to do this now. And she was, I forget what. Yeah,
I don't know anything about how that went down.
I don't remember what show she was doing before. And then they just came to her and they said, okay, we're going to switch you up and I'm going to have you do the classic rock show now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, oh, okay. And I mean, of course, I didn't really know Salton at the time. And, you know, I'm like, well, that's not very nice. It's like, you know, them coming to me and telling me I'm going to do a hip hop and rap show. I'm I don't think so.
Listen, I kind of get what they were doing. They're like, we're trying to improve our stance here. Maybe the station was struggling a little bit and they felt like they needed to make some changes. I've been there. All right. We've made some big changes when we had to here. You know, we've had to let some people go. That didn't fit with what we wanted to do.
We have.
Yeah. And it wasn't nothing personal with any of them. I genuinely like everybody that we hired, that I've worked with. I genuinely like them. I still do. Some of them don't like me anymore. And that's fine. I can't help that. I got to, you know, but I would never, ever. And that was one of the premises we founded this on it's your show. You own your show. As long as it's not horrible and it's not offensive to anybody. You know, as long as it's a fit, you can do your show the way you see it. And like the format of your show and all that, it's yours. You pick it, you do it. And you live with the consequences. You know, because some morning, genres Mel. Don't bring it. Good morning, Mel. Some genres don't bring in as many people. And you just have to be okay with that.
Yeah, it's tough sometimes when you're in that some genres don't pull as many people.
Mm-hmm.
That's tough.
When you see other people's, yes.
Yeah, you see struggling numbers and other people have flying, you know, raving success with their mm-hmm. shows, and you're like, why am I in the shitter? And it's tough.
It is. But we will never, WBAM, if it ever gets to that point, I'll stop it. If we're starting to tell people what they can play and what they can't play and what they could, you know, like I've had discussions like Rosanna's show. Like it was a show that I created in my head. It was, this is how I want this to be. And I took that to her. I'm like, is this something you want to do? And she said, yes. So in that respect, I did do that show that way. It was my idea. To do it that way. But it was her show. Once she took it over, she made it her own. And that's what I wanted. I wanted her personality, since she was the host, to come through. But that's probably as close as I've come to, hey, do this show this way.
I missed that show.
Yeah, it was a good show. Saturday Night Jams took its place, and it's still a show about love, but it's not. Not the same show.
No, it's different. It's a good show, mm-hmm. but it is different.
It is different.
It's the format is very different.
And it's not like how I pictured her show. I can't do how I pictured her show because I think it needs a female touch. I don't have that. I mean, I have vagina, but I don't have a female touch.
Yeah, well, I don't know. Sometimes I'm not sure she's...
Well, she's not 100%. She is very...
She's not.
She's very fluid.
Sometimes I picture her with a beard and, you know,
You gonna sit here and tell me you don't pluck them hairs out your face? Come on, Jen. You act like you ain't got no beard either.
Oh, honey, it's maintenance. If I don't get rid of these, I could grow full beard. Billy Goat City.
You'd have them public hairs all over your face, and you know it.
Public hairs. She's killing me.
She's just crude, man. I don't know how she even exists.
I do.
Yeah. We'll have that discussion someday. Yeah, we probably already have. But yeah. Shows are hard. They're hard to like get ready. There's a lot of work that goes into it. Now, the system I have, like last night it failed me, but it was because I wasn't on my game. There was things going wrong and I wasn't catching it right away because my brain was just a little mushy.
I was a little tipsy by the end of the show.
Yeah. I made a lot of mistakes.
Not any more than usual, really.
Really? Yeah, well, it seemed like really? More. It seemed like more.
You were just more aware of them.
Could be.
You were watching for them because you were fucked up.
Yeah. Well, not only that, I wanted you guys to drink, so I would never make for a mistake you, on purpose. But
for those of you out in Bama land, we have a drinking game that we play during Bonfire on Thursday nights. And every time Bon Lee fucks up, we have to take a drink. Last night we were all a little tipsy. It's fun time.
Hey, listen, I'm okay with all that. I like being the butt of the joke sometimes.
I'm glad.
I
enjoy making you the butt of the joke.
I'm not gonna lift the curtain to the back of the room too much. We'll break through the fourth wall, but yeah, it's all good with me. I like my show. I like everybody that comes and hangs out, and the numbers are always really good, and it's fun. It makes it fun.
It is. It is a fun show. I enjoy it. Makes it a little tough to get up on Friday mornings.
It does, man. I was tired this morning. I tried to get all my shit done last night. As far as, you know, like uploading my podcast and all that right after. And I did get it done, but now I'm a little yawny.
Well, when I spend the evening listening to a show, I try to, after the show, I try to spend a little bit of time with my husband before bed. And last night, I was really tired last night, but I managed to stay awake and watch a movie. I think I was up to 1 or 1:30 with him before I came to bed. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, after waking up early, and I had to get up extra early because I was so tired that I skipped the shower before I went to bed. So I'm like, when I get up in the morning, I have got to get my shower. So I got up a little bit earlier so I could jump in the shower. Because as I told you last night, we've got a big day planned today. Mm-hmm. Going to the laundromat.
So, get your pukey comforter.
Yes. Wash my pukey comforter. So anyway, I knew I had to jump in the shower before showtime this morning. Mm-hmm. So I got up a little early. But I really don't feel too tired yet. It'll hit me early afternoon. I'll be like, oh, I need a nap. And I'll have a nice comfy comforter to climb under.
I like those duvet things.
No, that's too thin for me. I got to have something that's like all cozy.
Yeah.
I get cold.
Our duvets are not thin.
Really?
Yeah, they're super heavy.
Yeah, they're heavy, but aren't they, like, the duvet is something that, like, you put, like, a quilt or a blanket or something inside the cover, right?
Yeah, it's a, well, we use, it's, they're pre-made, so it's not like a quilt, but yeah. Yeah, there's a blanket inside of the duvet cover.
Right.
So it becomes a pretty heavy comforter-like thing when it's done. I like it. I can't be too warm. We have quilts. I sleep with a quilt. Her mom made me a quilt that has evil ways on it. Well, that's what that's her thing. She's a quilt maker. They're like one generation away from Amish. But yeah, she has this whole sewing thing that she sews stuff. So she sewed me a couple quilts, actually. One of them had the evil ways on it. One was just regular. They're nice.
How cool.
Very warm. Yeah, she took one of those t-shirts like I sent you guys.
Yeah.
And used it to cover one of the pieces. So.
Well, that's pretty cool.
So it's all black and red, and then it has that evil ways in the center. Well, I played their, they have a company / public picnic that they do every 4th of July. So my band played there a few times. They got tired of the AC/DC, though. It was too much. And I don't blame them. It's a lot.
I don't either.
And it's loud. So.
I don't know why we're even friends.
What do you mean?
Because we have, like, when you think about the things that we have in common, like our likes and dislikes,
mm-hmm.
there are very few things that we actually have in common. Like, our personalities are pretty similar, but our likes and dislikes are polar opposite. And
just because we travel different roads. We're still the same people. We're just on different roads. That's all.
I mean, I'm pretty.
I'm not.
You said it. You know I'm kidding.
We have different plumbing. There's lots different about us. And if that's what you choose to focus on, that's what you'll find. Differences. But if you like the similarities, then... If that's what you look for, that's what you'll find.
Well, I'm not looking or not looking for anything. I mean, what it boils down to is that
your personality does that for you. You don't have to.
I like you.
We are attracted to energies and we are attracted to personalities. Not so much likes and dislikes. We're allowed to, I think it's okay to have different stuff. I think it creates, success in relationships. If you're 100% the same, you have all the same likes, it's going to get crowded in that room.
And boring.
Not. I don't know about boring, but maybe. I mean, potentially.
I mean, eventually you would run out of, I like that too. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, I like that. It's going to get boring. You have to have some opposition.
I was so conscious of this kind of stuff that I literally changed what my favorite color was when I was married to my first wife because she had the same favorite color and I didn't want to have the same favorite color as her.
Oh, we do have the same favorite color.
So I was like, okay, green was my second favorite color. So I made that my favorite color when her and I would have a car. What's your favorite color? You know, I ask her first and she's like, orange. I'm like, well, mine's green then. Just to be different because I didn't want to be the same. And it was a lie. Orange is my favorite color. Fuck off. Don't take my stuff. That's what I should have said.
You know, so I think so few people actually have orange as their favorite color.
Really?
Yeah, I don't think that's a common pick.
Well, it's not a base color. So I think you fall under the red. When you're an orange person.
Does that have some kind of personality?
I don't know.
Something or other?
I wish I was smart enough and educated enough to know that.
Well, does anybody know? I would like to know if that has some kind of personality thing. If you have favorite colors and does it reveal anything? Tisha
Melanie,
would be the one to know.
Melanie's
favorite
color is mixed too. She says her favorite color is purple.
So
that's a blue-red mix. So I don't know.
Hmm.
I wonder if it's contextual. Like, we like things a certain way, but with a twist. She said, Tisha says it's kind of like your auras.
Your auras, yeah.
Aura. Mm. I hate that word.
Really?
Yeah, because it always thought it was aura. And then someone spelled it as like aura. I'm like, I don't like that.
I don't know. Isn't that just kind of a difference in pronunciation? It's probably the same word, though, right? Listen,
my mom was from Long Island, New York. So, aura. It was like, That's their aura.
Okay.
Aura.
Tisha says,
pass me
she
the
says,
water.
Like she, you remember when she described... When she described us way back, I do remember when she said that. And she said I was a sexy beast.
And mine was black.
Which and, but then I'm she said that didn't. Which, she said yeah. She said that didn't mean what you thought it meant.
Mm-hmm. I know what it meant.
I forget what she said it meant, but she said it didn't mean what you think. Because I mean, I think black. I think stay away, fucking evil.
No, I didn't think it meant evil. I thought it meant I was dying. went the opposite way, like it was fading out, like I had a color before and then it turned to black.
Like a I thought like black soul, you know, like no soul.
Just me. I don't know. Now I want to cry.
Now you what?
Now I want to cry because I have a black soul.
You don't
have a soul.
You don't. You have. If I were to describe your soul in a color, it would be probably orange.
I was going
to
say, bitch, you better say orange. I'm going to come through this fucking microphone.
It's probably orange because you're, I mean, that's just me. You know, I have no knowledge, no nothing about this. This is just my gut telling me that you're orange because you're fiery and you're full of energy and you're fun and passionate. And
that I am.
Yes.
I do love hard. But that makes you fall hard too. When you trip, it hurts. Just the way it is. Get a lot of skinned up knees and elbows. Skin my knee on my heart.
I learned not to fall.
Yeah, it's a bad learn. Sometimes it's worth it. Sometimes it's not. Have you ever noticed relationships are just like that? Almost down the line, they're never even. One side,
they're not.
And that polarity can change throughout the relationship.
Well, no, I want to clarify that they're not the same if you're speaking romantically.
I'm talking about one person's attraction to the other.
Right.
Somebody always pulls harder.
But in a romantic sense.
Yes.
Friendships, I think, are pretty even.
Yeah, because you don't have to live with those people.
Sometimes you do.
Well, I can tell you, how many people have you lived with that you're still friends with? Extended periods of time, not just like a couple months. I can tell you what the answer is.
None.
It's hard. It's hard to live with people. Have traveled your road and you have your ways. And you have to be a special kind of person to be like, okay, I have to accommodate this other being's roadmap and with mine because it's the only way to work. If you don't do
that,
it's gonna
flunk. That's what I started to say too. Mel said she's never lived with a friend. And you know, I'm thinking back. I don't think I have either. I've lived with family, and I've lived with spouses.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't. I've never lived with a friend like long term. I crashed on a friend's couch for a month or so, but
I did it for 3 years. But I was an over the road driver, so I wasn't always there. Matter of fact, I was gone a lot, and that made it a lot easier. And him and I are still friends. And his dad's in hospice right now, and I'm just thinking about you, buddy.
Yeah, I'm sorry to hear that. You've suffered quite a bit of loss. You've suffered a lot of loss lately. Sad. Sorry.
It's okay. But yeah, it's hard. And him and I got into it at the end. But we're still tight. We this is like boys. Like, let's lay some shit out here. Boak and I got into it a while ago over some dumb shit. And he left chat and came back in. And I don't know if it was you I was talking to about it or somebody else. And they're like, well, how are you going to smooth that over? I'm like, we're boys. This is a playground. We got into a tussle. Tomorrow we won't even remember about it. That's how guys are. They can get at each other's shit, have a fight, and then the next day it's gone. They don't even remember. And I can't speak for every woman, but the ones that I've had experiences with, they never fucking forget.
No, women hold grudges.
Ever.
But at the same time, that is part of the reason why I don't have a lot of female friends, because yeah. I really don't. I think this is a real generalization, but women are so catty, and they're so.
I've heard. I mean,
they will. Women will tear other women down. Like, just big for jealousy, or I don't know. I don't understand why women do it. And as soon as I pick up that vibe from someone, I am done.
Yeah. So I prefer the company of women when I'm in a social setting. Men tend to want to, like, be violent. And while I have the capacity, and I have been violent in my life, I don't want to be, and I don't like it, and I don't, it's not me. People have forced me into that corner, and I tried to explain this to my son when he was growing up. You know, when he probably saw some shit he shouldn't have seen, because sometimes people will put me into a corner, and you don't put baby in a corner. I'm just sorry, you don't do that, because the claws are coming out. But I told him, the violence is only the answer when you're too stupid to think of another one. If you can't come up with a better solution and it's the only one, then it's because you're dumb. And I've been dumb a lot. So, but it's the truth. And if you think about that.
Did your lesson, did it sink in?
No. I've gotten a couple calls, you know, where you get beat up at the bar and it's like, hey, come help. Nope, I ain't doing it. Don't go to the fucking bars. That's the lesson you need to learn right here. Because when you're out going hee, 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 ha, 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 and drinking beers and having fun with your friends and getting loud, you're annoying somebody else. And if you don't have your head on a swivel and you're not watching, somebody is going to walk up behind you and just punch you in the fucking head. And that's what happened to him a couple times. And I tried to tell him, listen, it's your fault because you went to a bar in a public place and got drunk with other men.
You know, that really surprises me, because after I met him, he's very intelligent, and he's a smooth talker.
Yeah, but can you imagine him drunk and being loud like he is?
Does it get louder?
Yes. And it annoys people. He doesn't understand that. He's got a very big personality and very big voice, and it carries.
Yeah.
And when you're drunk and other people are trying to have a quiet night out and they see the loud guy, you know, having fun with his friends and getting laughy and jokey, you know, and it happened to me too when I was young. And after about four or five good bar fights, I'm like, I'm done. I'm not going to bars anymore. I have a face that people want to punch.
You said that to me.
It's the truth. People just, they want to pick, and I'm not the guy to pick a fight with. I'm not like some big bruiser guy, but I grew up a skinny little redheaded cross-eyed kid. I was in a fight almost every day of my life, all the way up into high school too. I was skinny and people wanted to fuck with me. And I can tell you, I don't care how athletic you are. If you're in enough fights, you can get good at it. And it's unfortunate that I had to get good at it.
I was like a wallflower when I was young, when I was in school. And I mean, I just wasn't noticed. I wasn't popular. I just wasn't noticed. I was
I would have took that.
I don't know what that means.
I would have been a wallflower gladly.
Oh, as opposed to being picked on. Gotcha. Yep.
I was noticed.
Well, then as I got older, and I don't know if it was just gaining confidence or what happened, but I kind of became that, I don't know. For a little while, I took it the other way. Mm-hmm. I was a little more extreme, and I was a bully. I was mean.
Mm-hmm.
And I got in a couple of bar fights over stupid men, but but I did. And actually I got arrested once because of it. Why is that so funny?
I don't know. I just it's like an episode of Cops. But with somebody you know. So in my head, that's how it's playing
out. It was
out.
Bad. I made a bad lot of boy, bad decisions. Bad
what you gonna do? Of course, we all did.
I was wearing a shirt, though.
Yeah. It was probably a wife beater, right?
But I made a lot of bad decisions in my 20s. Mm-hmm. So. Led to bad things.
Yes. Me too. I got married too young. And probably half the bar fights I was in was her fault. She's mouthy as fuck.
So and you were defending her?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
That's what I did. I've started exactly two fights in my entire life. One, I was trying to show off for a girl in the eighth grade and I got my ass kicked. And two, it was when my first wife left me and I had a bunch of pent up anger. So I went to a bar, 40 something years old, found this young guy who was just all full of himself. And I was like, yep, he's the one. So he kept staring at me. So I kept staring back. And then eventually, you know, he escalated it and I beat the dog shit out of him. And it made it look like it was his fault because he got through out of the bar. They bought me a drink.
Oh my goodness.
Worked out really nice.
That was the wisdom of your 40s that got that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I outsmarted that guy by a mile. I still feel bad about that. I do. I really do. I feel bad about it. Because I shouldn't have done that, but he was looking for it. He found it. And I hope he didn't look for it anymore.
You can make a public apology right now.
Whoever you are, I am so sorry that I gave you stitches on three sides of your face. Leave drunk men alone.
See, now you've been cleansed.
Somewhat. Yeah. God damn. Talk about bad decisions, man. Alcohol was a bad decision for me, period. I'm not a good drunk.
Neither am I.
I'm not mean or anything, but I mean, if you or I are married, yeah, I'm wild. My clothes come off. I'm embarrassing.
Mine too.
It is bad.
I almost got a divorce at my, I've had a couple divorces myself, but I almost got a divorce at my 20th high school reunion. I made some bad decisions. I was not in my 20s.
No.
No. So, but I drank a little much. Made some bad decisions. Mm-hmm. I didn't care that my husband was sitting there.
Well, here's the thing, and this is the truth. As much as I hate to admit it, your drunk self is your real self. It's your subconscious self that you shove down.
I'm a hoe.
Listen, so am I. And that's one of the reasons I quit drinking. I was like, I cannot control myself. And it's not okay. From getting on my motorcycle and riding drunk, just being stupid, fucking stupid. I was like, that's it. I'm done. So right around 40, I quit. Actually, I was 35 when I quit drinking. And then I started again when I was 40. I got divorced, but it was only for a few months. Then I quit again. I started smoking back then, too, when I was 40, but only for a few months. When I quit the bars, I quit the cigarettes again. The cigarettes, actually, I took my mom to one of her COPD treatments, and I was like, yep, that's it. I'm done. Watched her struggle to breathe, and I was like, yeah. Yeah, this is stupid. No more cigarettes for me. And it had been, I think I quit when I was 32.
Then for another month, went again when I was 40, and going again.
Cigarettes are the devil.
They are.
There, I quit smoking in August of last year. I haven't smoked a cigarette since, but now there's not a day that goes by that I don't think about it.
No, it'll be a while before that passes.
It's not that I really want one. It's like there's, it just feels like there's something missing.
It's a physical habit, and it does.
Yes.
It feels like somebody cut a limb off.
There's something missing from my everyday.
Yep. It's like somebody cut a limb off, and you can still feel that limb.
Yep.
I still reach in my pocket sometimes. I've caught myself doing
it. It doesn't help that you know, Wayne, my husband, he still smokes. He tried to quit. It didn't stick. So he's still smoking. And
Melanie's
and
right.
I have to, you know, I watch him.
It is the hardest thing to quit.
Yep. I watch him, you know, go out to smoke. And the only thing that helps is when he comes back in the house, he stinks.
The best deterrent for smoking for me was the social stigma. When it wasn't cool anymore. That helps. That helps when you can't smoke in your house. You can't smoke here. You can't smoke there. In Ohio, you can't smoke anywhere inside.
Nowhere, no.
They let you smoke in your house because they can't tell you what to do in there yet, but it's a bad idea. Anyway, it ruins your paint. It ruins your furniture. It's just your ceilings.
You know,
it's gross.
My daughter told me, I think it was my daughter who was telling me, that they've now, you can't vape in a public space either.
Yeah,
like anywhere in a public space. It's
it can't
same
be good for you, right?
Well, I realize that, but at what point are we going to draw the line about what you can do and what you can't, and it being against the law? At what point do we say enough's enough that you're not?
I think
going
we've gone
to
too far already, and that's the problem. We've gone too far already. We should allow social shaming to take care of the fucking problem. They should be making laws about it.
Right. Well,
the bitch that sits across from you at the table going, should be enough deterrent for you not to smoke in public. That should be enough.
Agree. I agree. And I never would. When I was a smoker, I never
Same.
Smoked around people.
I didn't want to offend anybody.
No.
I chewed tobacco
never,
at the same time. Mel saying it's better than tobacco. I chewed tobacco. I dipped Copenhagen since I was 9 years old up until I was in my 40s, and I smoked on top of it. I would literally smoke with a chew in my mouth.
Yeah, Wayne's done that. Wayne chewed because he worked in the mines.
Right. Yeah, you can't smoke down there.
You can't smoke underground.
Mm-hmm.
So he had to chew. And then so chewing became a habit on top of the smoking, you know, so he would still have a chew in his mouth and smoke a cigarette with a nicotine patch on.
Let's get it on. Throw me on.
He's going to blow his heart up with them too.
Throw me all that nicotine you got at once. I'll chew now on he one vapes. Of them patches.
Now he vapes and smokes and wears a nicotine patch.
Well, listen. Hey, at least he's trying.
Is he, though?
I don't know.
No. No. He tries to throw that, too. He's like, well, I'm trying. I'm wearing a patch, and I'm trying to vape. I'm like, maybe pick one or the other and maybe, you know, stick to that method, not just do it all, because he's just getting so much. He'll never quit. He'll never quit.
Probably not. It's really hard. And I went through all that stuff. I took the pills, did the patch, did the gum. None of it worked. None of
you
it
know
made
what
it,
I don't like?
None of it made it easy.
You know what I don't like about the gum?
Nasty
is that it's stuff. Not really, it's not really, well, yeah, it's gross, but it's not really gum.
Yeah, you don't chew it.
You don't chew it. It's like, what? Yeah, I don't like that.
Yeah, it's dumb.
I want
to. They need to figure out how to make that actual gum.
Yeah.
But yeah. All right. Well, on that note, we're going to call an end to the bullshit. And we will pick back up Monday morning at 9 a.m. here on WBAM. I want to see if this fucking promo. I know we're already playing Morning Bowl, but I want to see if it works.
Let's play it.
Melanie, you're paying attention in chat out there. Tisha, one of you, tell me if you hear the Morning Bowl promo.
What the hell was that?
Oh, that's just Jen and Molly out there shooting the bull again.
Catch Morning Bull with Bonley, Johnson, and Jen as they shoot the bull about anything, everything, and absolutely nothing at all every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 9 a.m. Eastern. Exclusively on your home for badass music and more. WBAM Radio.
No okay. Farm animals, including Bonnie Johnson, were harmed in the making of this promotion.
Good. So the promo worked. I don't know what I did last night. I had something set up wrong and it wouldn't play. It played in my ear. I'm like, laughing. And Heather's like, I can hear you breathe. I can hear you breathing. That's all we can hear.
And, well, I know at one point you said, and she is the co-host, actually, I think you said host, of this show.
Mm-hmm. And then it went blank. But anyhow, yes. And anyone who's listening, Tisha is on live tonight. Tisha, I believe it is, is it 9 p.m. or 8 that you start?
8.
It's 8.
She starts
right?
at 8.
Same as me, yes.
Yep.
8 p.m. Eastern on WBAM. Come listen to Putting on the Mix with Little T. And hopefully
and
Big
Patty
P,
Cakes.
Too. Yeah, I like when they're together. When they're together, it's my favorite show. They crack me up, dude. I can't get enough. I know as a parent, I shouldn't pick favorites. But they fucking crack me up, dude. I can't get enough.
They're funny.
They're funny. And it's when they're not trying.
Sometimes.
Yeah, I know. And it's when they're not trying. When it's just like him, he's picking on her and she's like, shut up. It's the fucking best. All right. That's enough. We're going to go for now.
Right.
We will see you all Monday. Jen, I love you. Have a good weekend, everybody. And be kind. It's not that hard.
Maybe. Man. Love you too. And I hope everybody has a fantastic weekend. I look forward to tuning in tonight at 8. I will be here, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. And I'll be right here listening.
The creek will be fine. All right. Peace and love, everybody. Talk to you soon.
See you Monday.